Welcome to you all at this 2015 WRR lecture event. Great that you are with us. When the Scientific Council for Government Policy planned this event earlier in this year, the topic Europe in crisis was obviously highly relevant. Since then, it has only continued growing in importance day by day, with the aftershocks of the financial crisis being more or less overwhelmed by a refugee crisis, actual and feared terrorist attacks, a conflict in the East, and an expanding war situation in the Middle East, in which the Dutch role might increase. As often happens with crises, various problematic developments come together in a nasty mix of complexity. While well-concerted policies would help, we are confronted with problems of government and governance of the European Union, and with issues regarding public engagement and disengagement, and with perceived tensions between national interests on the one hand and the need for collaboration in economy and geopolitics on the other. Clearly, the topic of today encompasses so many challenges that we can easily lose sight of a bigger picture that may guide us. And can we indeed discern patterns that might provide us with some beacons? What can we learn if we zoom out to longer timelines, connecting past, present, and looking ahead? And what does this imply for the very near Dutch presidency of the European Union? Ladies and gentlemen, in a journey with longer timelines, it's crucial to have outstanding guides. And we are delighted to have as our guides today Mark Mazower, Beatrice de Graaf, and Ernst Hirst Ballin. We will introduce the latter two speakers later. We will start now with the central keynote speaker, Professor Mark Mazower. He is director and chair of the Heyman Center for the Humanities at Columbia University, New York. And he is a world-leading historian with a keen eye for present and future societal challenges. He is specializing in modern Greece, 20th century Europe, and international history. He studied philosophy at Oxford and international affairs at Johns Hopkins University's Bologna Center, and he has a doctorate in modern history. He has written numerous books, most recently Governing the World, The History of an Idea. Other examples of his numerous books are Hitler's Empire, the Balkans, and Dark Continent, Europe's 20th century. For his work, he was frequently awarded at the highest level, for example, with the Wolfson Prize for History, the Duff Cooper Prize, and extremely important in nowadays academia, the Society of Columbia Graduates Great Teacher Award. As a true intellectual involved in the public debate, he also publishes a lot on current affairs in leading media such as the Financial Times, The Guardian, and the London Review of Books. By the way, there is another person named Mark, being an historian and very much involved with Europe, our Prime Minister, Mark Rutte. He was not able to attend, but invited Mark, the other Mark, op het torentje today, and I can say they had a lively discussion. Mark Mazower, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, André, and thank you very much to the WRR for the very kind invitation and wonderful hospitality, and it's a great pleasure to be back in The Hague, a real pleasure. These are troubling times for the continent, critical times. People can agree on precious little regarding Europe, but one thing they can agree on is this: The policy changes are multiple and complex, but the fundamental problem, I think, is something deeper and more profound than a question of this or that policy. 200 years ago, Europe was a slogan, a set of principles, without an organization. Today, Europe is an organization, or a complex of them, in search of principles. Or perhaps better, in search of new principles to replace some of the old ones. To articulate, to redefine these, requires us to raise ourselves above the sense of crisis for a moment and to try to see things in the longer term. I say this because I believe we're at a historical turning point, although one that has been little understood. There was the age in which Europe was little more than a slogan. This lasted roughly from 1815, and we'll hear more about that shortly, until 1945. There was the age, the golden age maybe, in which Europe began to emerge as a project, unprecedented, but actually modest in scope compared with today, roughly speaking, the years between 1950 and 1980. And there was a third phase, from around the end of the Cold War, in which a union itself intensified, even as states weakened and economies boomed, a phase that ended abruptly in 2009. And there's now. In this lecture, I'll begin by giving a brief historian's perspective on how Europe's meanings have changed over time in this way, tracing what has happened as we move from the age of ideas, the long 19th century, into that of organizations and international bodies, so that we can ask what principles might survive from this history to guide us and to breathe new life into the organizations themselves. I'll then turn to how the geopolitical setting has inflected the definition and ambit of the European project, or better, projects, over the last century. I'm not a professional urologist, so all I can hope to contribute is a historian's perspective, better at discerning long-run trends than setting guidelines for short-term policy, least of all in a moment of crisis. But because much of the problem, I think, has been reinforced by the wrong kind of historical thinking, by the easy appeal to historical stereotypes, by the astonishing persistence of huge gulfs in understanding between different nations, it may be helpful too to say something about where history should and should not be invoked. The nature of this conjoined crisis and the interrelations between the impact of austerity on the one hand and the refugee crisis on the other, complicated further now by the recent terrorist attacks in Paris and elsewhere, demand some kind of contextualization if we're to figure out the options for the future. So let me begin with some history. At the start of the 19th century, both Napoleon and his opponents used Europe in a political sense, and I'd say this is more or less new. Napoleon's gesturing to the idea of a continent unified by rational legislation never seemed able at the time to shake off its French origins, and yet, of course, his actual influence over legislation and habits of thought across the continent was immense. It was the victors at Vienna, exactly two centuries ago, who were perhaps the first to think through the relationship between Europe and power. For them, to be sure, it was primarily a policing matter, a means of forestalling revolution, even when that meant trampling on the rights of smaller states and nations. Indeed, when Metternich's secretary, Gentz, said that Europe, quote, seems really to form a grand political family, it was principally to legitimize the truly astonishing power the four victorious powers over the French had arrogated to themselves. The fear that talk of Europe was just a device to suppress revolution, that its essence was what the British Foreign Secretary George Canning called, quote, the doctrine of a European police, Europe equaled police, was powerful so long as Metternich in particular was in power. And this equating of Europe with counter-revolution was reinforced by the spread of the idea inherent in the Monroe Doctrine of a world divided into two, a new world of popular republics and an older European world of monarchies and autocracies. This conservative vision of Europe was important chiefly because it provoked a counter-discourse that also saw itself in European terms. Those who opposed it were a motley crew of pacifists, free traders, early socialists, and radicals. Among them were some, their future influence greater than at the time, who saw in Europe the possibility of a democratic political ideal. Giuseppe Mazzini, the Italian revolutionary, is the outstanding example of someone who wanted to rescue the idea of Europe from the diplomats and recast it as a community of peoples. The Mazzinian conception, crucial for anyone wanting to understand Europe today, involved, and this is the important thing, a synthesis of nationalism and internationalism. The task for the radicals of appealing to popular opinion over the heads of their rulers involved projecting a sense of national community. But for Mazzini, this was not only compatible with internationalism, it required it. Today, it's perhaps hard to recapture the logic of this, but it was a very influential conception, and I think it's actually what's helped the European community of states to flourish. 3 years after founding his revolutionary organization, Young Italy, Mazzini founded Young Europe, a coordinating body to unify national revolutions that he hoped would bring down the Holy Alliance. What he need, we wrote, is a single union of all the European peoples striving towards the same goal. That goal was the toppling of despotism. To be a nationalist, an Italian or a Polish or a Hungarian nationalist, meant to think internationally, if only because your enemies were doing the same thing. Of course, what union meant for Mazzini was completely indeterminate. Bear in mind, we're talking about a period, early middle 19th century, when there are no international organizations in existence of any kind at all. This balancing the reciprocal development of nationalism and internationalism outlived Mazzini and profoundly shaped the 20th century. On the one hand, there was communism. Karl Marx was, of course, notoriously hostile to Mazzini and his message. One reason for his hostility was that in many ways, Marx's message was so similar. Not only was Marx's own vehicle, the International Working Men's Association, composed of national committees, but his most important followers, Lenin and the Bolsheviks, quickly realized, even before 1917 was out, that their internationalism necessitated coming to terms with nationalism as well. And if international communism cast an internationalist vision in nationalist terms, so did their main opponents in the shape of US President Woodrow Wilson and the liberals who followed him. For Wilson, national self-determination and the League of Nations were two sides of the same coin, a realization of the Mazzinian project. And Wilson was a great worshipper at the shrine of Mazzini. Now, where did this leave what scholars usually refer to as the European idea after 1919? Although we don't usually think of it this way, the League of Nations was, in a way, a kind of proto-European governance body. A large number of its members were European, many of the principal security issues it dealt with were in Europe, and above all, it was the product of a very Eurocentric age, which is to say one in which the stability of Europe was regarded as the central diplomatic priority of the times. It was wars that Europeans started that were world wars, not those that took place in South America or anywhere else. Why else do we still date the start of the Second World War to 1939, rather than, say, 1931 or 1941? And there were, of course, a number of specific ways in which the League shaped Europe, primarily in the realm of technical services and infrastructure, that foreshadowed later developments. But there were limits to all of this. When the French Foreign Minister Aristide Briand tried to work through the League in 1929 and 30 to prop up East European wheat prices in the name of Europe, he failed. The League's tentative steps to model a new kind of diplomacy through international cooperation were constrained. They were constrained by the tendency of the great powers to continue to run the affairs of Europe in the 19th century fashion, that's to say, one in which statesmen and diplomats were still much more important than bureaucrats or lawyers, not true today. And they were constrained by the fact that as a body, the League was so associated with the Versailles peace settlement. Europe was simply too divided ideologically between the wars for any robust form of Europeanism to take effective root. All of this changed with the Second World War, which added two important new strands to the formation of thinking about Europe. One of these, and in a sense we're its heirs today, was federalism. When Briand had proposed a federal United States of Europe in 1930, he'd been laughed down. But the idea after 1939 that the war had been caused by nationalism led to federalism becoming immensely popular right across the world. And although it declined in force after 1945, within many sectors of the European resistance, federalism remained pronounced, especially among some of the founding fathers of the European community. Among these, Spinelli would be a key example. There was often a strong Mazzinian influence. So we have a line that takes us back from the founding of the common market all the way to Mazzini, and it's not a very long way. But ever closer union is a phrase and an aspiration that clearly reflected that wartime moment, the need, as people then saw it, to compete with the two unions of the future, the one across the Atlantic, the United States of America, and the one to the east, the Soviet Union. We cling to this phrase like a child clings to a blanket, and we forget how old it is and where it came from. Also during the war, though less emphasized by historians of the European Union for a long time, key forms of practical economic cooperation, say in the Ruhr, were emerging under the Germans and espoused in one way or another by Berlin. French and Belgian coal and German steel could not live without one another, for instance. The Danish dairy farmers depended on the German market, all that through the war. And these two reflected a specific moment in time, this time in the development of the European economy, which still had significant peasantries and concentrations in sectors characteristic of the old Industrial Revolution. And these two strands would in many ways comprise the main two dimensions of the post-war Europeanism that led to the common market. On the one hand, the idea that some form of some pooled sovereignty, some version of federalism, however understood, would be necessary. Why? To prevent fascism recurring. Federalism was anti-fascism, and anti-fascism was a peace policy for the continent. That was one strand. And the other, which was not coming from young Madsenian radical activists, but from businessmen and civil servants, was the realization that had first dawned in wartime Berlin, and was then relearned in Bonn and Paris and London after the war, that the prosperity of the West European economies necessitated cross-border cooperation between industries and other sectors, something that political scientists would later call functionalism, theorizes functionalism. What conclusions should we draw from this historical sketch? One is, there was never one conception of why Europe mattered, and not only were there multiple versions, but often they were mutually opposed. Europe was from the start about choices and principles. Second, that as we've learned from historians of this, the path to European integration in the form that it eventually took was a twisted and unpredictable one. If this was true before 1945, it was no less true afterwards. The core impulse to build Europe was overwhelmingly that of enshrining a lasting peace, but the question of how to get there was not at all clear, and there were many false starts and dead ends. We have learned, for instance, that the Council of Europe was originally conceived as something far more substantial than it became in the post-war era. Or the European Defence Community, which was the plan for a pan-European military that was designed to solve the problem of how to rearm the Germans. This was so ahead of its time that it died in the French Parliament, 1952. The Americans originally had plans to create a serious transnational European planning mechanism in association with the Marshall Plan, but these dwindled in scope until they turned into what is now the OECD. Now, the OECD is not nothing, but it's nothing on the scale of a transnational European planning organization. One wonders what the architects of the European Court of Justice would make today of its current enormous role as enforcer of the 2012 treaty, enforcing austerity in the name of fiscal stability. In fact, the real start of the Europe we've grown up in, the push of the mid-50s and the creation of the common market, with its twin achievements of a slow liberalization of commerce and cross-national subsidies, mostly for peasants, was in many ways a kind of reset, a response to the failure of these earlier European initiatives. These developments took place in the context of a post-European world, one in which Europe had lost the ability to determine its own future, amid the Cold War and the essential American security guarantee. That's one difference with the present. But another, I think more important, is that although these European initiatives towards integration represented a kind of retreat away from interwar autarky, was only a very gradual retreat. Exchange controls were not lifted immediately. Restrictions on capital movements remained in force in many countries well into the 1950s, if not longer. And state economic planning remained a principal vehicle for state dirigism on both sides of the Iron Curtain. Capital controls after 1929 had become a new orthodoxy, and they were indeed permitted in the founding articles of the IMF, where, astonishingly, they still remain to this day. So this modesty of goals, what Europe could do, was matched by Europe's geographical limits. The Europe of the founding six was obviously a very different beast in every way from today's Union, and its principal goal was to reintegrate West Germany into a new European order. There was, of course, the rhetoric of ever closer union, but at a time when trade to GNP averages, if you want to use that as a proxy for openness or closeness, when that kind of average was much lower than it is today, when economies therefore were relatively closed, this kind of rhetoric could be understood primarily as necessary to prevent a return to the autarky of the interwar years and warding off the depression that many commentators of Europe in the 1950s feared was still just around the corner. What strikes me in retrospect is how, by comparison with today, how un-European the Trente Glorieuses, the years of the truly extraordinary post-war economic boom, the miracle, were. Two very significant goals were achieved at that time. One, of demonstrating that capitalism didn't necessarily lead to periodic depression and mass unemployment. The other, that a new Franco-German relationship was possible, that abjured war and made it unthinkable. The common market was part of this dual learning process, but only part. When the post-war boom petered out amongst the oil shocks of the 70s, European integration had effectively been on hold for some time. I think, therefore, it's salutary to realize that the period of post-war reconstruction, which effectively reconciled Europeans to democracy, showing them that it could guarantee a humane and peaceful form of capitalism, was a period in which European integration made only modest strides forward. The nationalism-internationalism balance that I alluded to at the start as being so important in Europeanist thought accommodated in those days a much more robust version of a national autonomy than could be possible today. National control over monetary policy, migration policy, labor relations, long-range development planning, all of these things were the responsibility of national states. The popularity of the European idea was reinforced by its association with these very positive political and economic developments. Also striking is that before 1979, there was relatively little discussion of the question today of European legitimacy, of the legitimacy of European institutions. At that time, the European Parliament was, thanks chiefly to de Gaulle, of much less consequence than it is today. The European Economic Community before 1985, or its prior incarnations before 1985, had felt no need for a flag. And even then, in 1985, the flag that it adopts was the circle of stars that the Council of Europe had adopted back in 1955. In other words, it's actually not until the end of the Cold War that the European community encounters the question of legitimation to any significant degree. Now, of course, when it did, it was in an era of very sudden, spectacular geopolitical transformation. I want to single out three critical changes in the context of the European story at the end of the 20th century. First, massive expansion of the club. In the 80s in Southern Europe, in the 90s in Eastern Europe, expansion of membership was essentially driven by political imperatives, whose economic and social consequences it was felt could be left to be taken care of later. I don't need to go into the difficulties this was bound to cause for an organization, the Union, that was simultaneously widening and deepening its competences. The much greater complication of ratifying policies, the extension of membership to countries with relatively weak or corrupt states, the reliance on Commission bureaucracy and European legal mechanisms to minimize the political complexities, all of these intensified the legitimacy crisis. On the other hand, the Union's legitimacy was massively enhanced. I think we should be struck not by the difficulties that followed enlargement, but rather by the success with which much poorer regions on the south and eastern periphery of Europe were formally integrated into the governance mechanisms of the Union. Could rely at this time, and to a large extent still can, on its symbolic association with the successful economic and security record of Western Europe in surmounting the legacy of the two world wars. And it proved, through the extraordinarily peaceful way in which integration took place, that this new Europe did, the former Yugoslavia aside, seem to have moved into a phase historically unprecedented since the rise of the nation state, one in which interstate war was all but unthinkable. It was a real achievement, and I don't think it's one that we should take for granted. The second aspect of this major, major geopolitical transformation in the 1990s was the impact of the globalization of markets, first commercial, and then, I think, even more consequentially, of financial markets. To my mind, this is actually where the most fundamental challenges for Europe now lie, because they implied a very, very significant reconfiguring of this balance between nationalism and internationalism. As I've emphasized, the post-war boom took place in an era when states still directed economic planning and mediated in industrial relations, an era of large peasantries, unionized workforces. But the acceleration of European integration in the late 20th century took place against a backdrop of spreading neoliberalism, the collapse of corporatist wage bargaining, shifts in the public-private balance, privatization of utilities, and a consequent transfer of competences from state executives and state legislatures to mixed regulatory agencies, tribunals, and constitutional courts. I've summed that up elsewhere as a shift from a world of government to a world of governance. If this change can only be seen as something quite new. The third and last change, maybe the most consequential, looks at first glance like something rather old-fashioned, the reunification of Germany. And hence the impact on the European Union for the first time of unquestioned German predominance. It wouldn't be going too far to say that the entire process of post-war European integration had been from the start a kind of transnational German policy, espoused simultaneously and in different forms, first by the British and the Americans, and then by the French, and now by the Germans themselves. That Europe was above all a means of winning the peace and winning the, and preserving the peace was understood by everybody after 1945. But now the peace is won, and Europe is, to simplify a little, but only a little, in German hands. In itself, this is neither a good nor a bad thing, I think. But what it means is that the fate of Europe hangs to an unprecedented degree on the wisdom and foolishness of German policy. And so we come to the fundamental institutional shift that accompanied German reunification, the creation of the Eurozone. There have always, of course, been skeptics about the very idea. Not me. I can see great advantages to a single currency area. What I do think is that the problem today is not monetary union itself, so much as the way that union has been managed and is managed. Put simply, the rules are the problem, and anyone who thinks they're not needs to explain to the hundreds and thousands of 20-somethings in Europe today facing a lifetime without employment. This was not immediately apparent because the euro, in effect, brought universal acceptance of the new German hegemony by demonstrating one of its immediate benefits, access to world capital, on terms that were justified principally by the underlying strength of the German and a few other economies. For a time, Europe appeared to occupy a privileged position in global markets, a beneficiary of financial globalization that was immune to the ever more frequent financial crises hitting other parts of the world, but only for a time. Because from 2009 on, this suddenly changed, of course. And at that point, as we know, all the underlying problems of a monetary union became visible. The widening gap between Northern and Southern Europe, the reduction of politics to a problem of financial management, the corrosive impact on politics in debtor countries, the shift to trying to lock supposedly unreliable MPs into constitutionally mandated fiscal commitments, and so on. Viewed from the debtor fringe, the question has been not why austerity, but why austerity pursued in this way and to this degree? Why was Europe locked into these Maastricht criteria? Why was it so comparatively easy to provide private sector relief to the banks in 2010, but hard to provide meaningful public sector relief? Austerity is the chief policy challenge for Europe, I believe, and the one that shows up most poignantly the crisis of long-term leadership at the top of the Union. But it's not only a Eurozone matter, although it can only be resolved probably within the Eurozone, but fiscal rules on government deficits with penalties that produce below target inflation with no penalties and historically high levels of unemployment also with no penalties, in many member states is clearly not behaving optimally and dragging down the Union. Right now we have an EU inflation rate of 0.1%. We have a youth unemployment rate across the EU of 20% plus. Short summary of this would be, policy serves those who are rich and old and doesn't serve those who are poor and young. That's obviously a gross simplification, but you can see why this is not going to help selling the EU. Although wars in the Middle East and Africa had, along with other factors, for years led to migrants and refugees from those regions making their way into Europe, the war in Syria has produced an inherently unsustainable situation, I think, qualitatively different from what preceded it. The data are very striking. 58,000 arrivals into the Union by sea, i.e. the Mediterranean, in 2008. That number actually fell to 10,000 in 2010. Suddenly people didn't want to come to depressed Europe. Rose abruptly from 58,000 again in 2014 to more than an incredible figure, 860,000 plus already this year, of whom 715,000 have come via Greece, completely overwhelming the country's never very efficient bureaucracy. Greece is a country I know fairly well, and we can go into what that means on the ground, if you like, in the discussion. Our response to this crisis will require an ability to differentiate, I think, because what we're facing in this is in large measure the product of the war in Syria. That is one thing. Ending the war there will not end the fact that people will want to enter Europe in future, but those numbers and those routes will no longer be nearly as significant. Second, I think we need to differentiate the Syrian refugee crisis from the question of terrorism. They're essentially different phenomena requiring different kinds of response. Of the five identified dead perpetrators involved in the Paris attacks, four were Belgian nationals with a Moroccan family background, and one was French. The chief connection to the Syrian refugee crisis is the fake passport that's been found at the scene that was made out in the name of a Syrian soldier now known to have died earlier in Syria. So there is a connection between these two, but it's not exactly a very strong one. Third, I think the refugee crisis is part of a larger question of political leadership in Europe and the way it's understood and presented matters. We can present it solely as a question of security and border management and political will, in which refugees are the kind of challenge to state authorities rather than a permanent feature of the modern world, and which they're essentially a threat to be neutralized, whether this is a security threat or a cultural threat. Or it can be seen in solidaristic terms as a test of what Europe stands for, a test of the Union's capacity to help others, a reminder of Europe's own origins actually in a war of massive population displacement. I think Chancellor Merkel's initiative last month was a remarkable expression of this, and I think she intuitively understood this. The Union suffers in general from what I would call a solidarity deficit, and I don't think it will prosper until it makes it up. And that requires explaining, among other things, the demographic case for immigration, something the aging European economy is actually going to need rather badly. I don't underestimate the difficulty of doing this at a time of growing introversion and xenophobia across the continent. It's not just, well, as we well know here, in Eastern Europe, the nasty forms of right-wing politics are on the ascendancy. And that's worrying because such people, when they're in power, do things that jeopardize Europe's commitment to democracy, because they thrive on conflict and capable of stupidities, sometimes with their neighbors, and because their nostalgia for a time that never was makes them fundamentally impatient of the kinds of political compromises the Union relies upon. But their rise needs to be explained, and austerity and the refugee crisis are really only parts of the reason. I think behind them there is a more fundamental factor, the poverty of the arguments currently being made in favor of Europe. What can Europe's supporters say? That it provides peace? Well, the peace is taken for granted. That its currency remains strong? I don't think a great political project will ever flourish on the basis of prudence alone. That the Union encourages growth? Not at the moment. Stability? But neoliberalism has actually weakened borders and state powers, above all in countries that are now being told their borders are their problem. There should, of course, be plenty to say about the merits of democracy and open debate, about concern for the environment and standards of living. So why isn't it being said more effectively? I think largely because the political articulation of the very idea of a common good has suffered enormously in the past 30 or 40 years. A policy of sauve-qui-peut is not a winning formula for Europe. Merkel's firm stance on refugee policy was impressive, a step in the right direction. But as long as German policy remains unchanged on austerity, Europe is going to be a hard sell, and I would add more than ever once quantitative easing in the US is abandoned. We've been living on borrowed time from that point of view. The euro's inflation figures are still worryingly under target, and fiscal contraction can get worse before it gets better. What are the implications of all of this? Obviously, one major shift in approach I'm advocating is ease off on the Maastricht rules and return to some kind of expansive role for spending on public works by the Commission and national governments. Greater flexibility in general regarding the way the European project is discussed would also be an improvement. Too often, anyone questioning the wisdom of the acquis communautaire is equated with hardline scepticism. The result is that we'd never have the debate we need about the institutions we've inherited. In fact, I think it's perfectly reasonable and perfectly European, if that's really an adjective, to question whether every step forward since 1979, say, has been an achievement. And by the same token, not every rollback or modification of competences need be regarded as a failure or the beginning of the end. A more relaxed attitude to what has been achieved might, in fact, be helpful. My own view, the 2012 Fiscal Stability Treaty was a very debatable achievement, for one thing, or the role allotted to the European Court of Justice for another. One could actually imagine reviews of these bodies and discussions emerging about whether they should have the competences that are assigned to them or perhaps others. Why not hail the flexibility of the Union and its sensitivity to changing circumstances? Ever closer union, in short, should not be an end in itself. Truth is, we find ourselves in a new historical phase. We've not grown up through depression, war, occupation, as Europe's founding fathers did. The old Europe was designed to make these things history, and it has. But if we stick to what they did and don't show adaptability and sensitivity to the needs of our times, their achievement will actually, I think, be jeopardized. Across the continent, electorates now take for granted what has been won, and actually they're not wrong to do this. They've grown up in times of peace. Franco-German war has become unthinkable. Low inflation and low unemployment became the norm and dictatorship an oddity. To protect these achievements, those guiding Europe will need to convey the sense of new historical challenges, of living in new times and thinking afresh about Europe and its needs. They will need, in short, to discover inside themselves something of the far-sightedness, the strategic sense, that an earlier generation possessed, but that's been lacking across the political spectrum in recent years. The most fundamental challenge is to find new ways in a globalized world of demonstrating once more that capitalism and democracy can be reconciled. Nothing could be harder now, especially given that the task is to reconcile capitalism not with one democracy, but with 28. The second challenge is to think about and to explain the significance of Europe's long-term demographic needs in connection with the refugee crisis in ways that make sense to people. Our existing terminology is hopeless. Refugees, migrants, the distinction is often very hard to make and perhaps ultimately pointless. The fact is, large numbers of people, however we categorize them, will try to reach Europe as long as it represents relative peace and prosperity. And at the same time, Europe needs people because its populations are aging fast. Fascist parties decry all this, but they have no real response to either. A word on Greece, maybe, is relevant here, as it finds itself at the center of the two most serious ongoing crises. Greece is deeply unfortunate, I happen to believe, in the caliber of its governing class, and I mean this across left and right. Their inability to come together at a time of national emergency really has no parallels elsewhere in the Union. But the message delivered by its voters has nevertheless been consistent across every election since the crisis erupted. They want to stay in the euro on new terms. Once one might have said this was just self-serving. But no longer, I think. It's not an unreasonable position now. And it suggests that while politicians may find it convenient to blame their voters for their nation's woes, sometimes, no doubt with good reason, there is often a leadership problem as well. Greece can serve as a warning of a different kind, too. It can show that political landscapes can change with astonishing speed in a real crisis. Look at how PASOK, the party of the centre-left, collapsed from over 40% of the vote to under 10 in only a few years, a remarkable case of instability. And actually, things could be worse than they are. In Greece, we've so far been spared real political instability, which would present the European Union with much greater dilemmas than it's had to deal with so far. And what about outside Greece? Suppose we witness the rise of a Nazi party on the scale of Golden Dawn in Western Europe, maybe in Germany itself. People might then take a little more seriously than they have until now the radicalizing potential of bad union policy. The thing I've been struck by most through the euro crisis is the power and persistence of historical stereotypes. Of course, the Greeks weren't lazy at all. The problem has been the system there, not the people. And actually, I know plenty of Germans and Austrians and Dutch living in Greece. They don't pay their taxes there either. The system is malfunctioning. Likewise, German policy is not best understood by conjuring up figures from the past, be they Hitler or Bismarck. Worse than insulting, such cartoon explanations really prevent us understanding the causes of what's happening, and yet their appeal seems eternal. The persistence of these national stereotypes has shown us how thin the European achievement really is. We have not done a good job of helping each other understand one another. We have to get through the present crises, even though some of them have no obvious solution, and even though the European Union is just not made for crisis management. But without a longer-term perspective and a greater strategic sense of what the Union is for, it will founder, and that is what's principally lacking. The media are culpable in their way too, but even though we have to live with them, what we don't need to do is run policy exclusively on short-term time horizons. What should be the characteristics of such a long-term strategy? I think restoring a sense of the stakes, of the longer perspective, which is not to say historical analogies. That's a nice game, I understand. Are we an empire? And if so, are we Romans or Habsburgs? Is the Union more like a medieval conglomeration? In that case, who is the Pope? Or perhaps, as Brion hoped, we can be like the United States, if only we can get there. The historical analogies are actually endless. The fact is, we're none of these things. We're in new times, facing new pressures. In bringing a new orientation to the formulation of European goals, I would stress flexibility. The old narrative stressed an inexorable telos, ever closer union. And it did so because history had presented so many, had placed so many obstacles to the thing ever getting off the ground at all. But now Europe is a reality, a highly complex set of organizations, procedures, and debates. They're very different now to what they were in the 50s. A Europe of 28 is already setting different speeds for different areas of policy. It needs to accept ever closer union may no longer be a desirable goal, short-term or long-term, and that to spell that out is not at all the same thing as being against Europe. With unemployment hovering close to 10%, it will have to choose, in my view, between austerity and ever-shrinking eurozone, or the fiscal expansion needed to keep the euro as a more or less continental currency. In my view, the union needs to be allowed to emerge as a mechanism for solidarity among peoples, and that means fiscal solidarity as well. In short, and to conclude, I'm a Europeanist on the old lines and for many of the old reasons. I think Europe is a goal that makes sense when it aims to improve living standards for its entire population. And this means fiscal and financial policy cannot alone fulfill the European mandate. I actually prefer some of Briand's priorities from 1930 for United States of Europe. Quote, public works, communication and transit, finances, labor, hygiene. That's a good order to put things in, I think. I think national states need to be internationalist, especially in Europe, especially now. Without a change of strategy, with many more years of ineffectual firefighting, I think we're in for a bleak few decades. This political elite belongs to a new generation that lacks the historical experiences of its predecessors. It will have to defend very much more strongly and imaginatively than it has done what will be lost if the Union loses its way. The more flexibility is built into economic policy, the more the Commission is allowed to play something approximating the role of an old strategic investment agency, the easier. My fear is that none of this, though none of it is by any means impossible, will be done, and that the alternative will be a new, harsher life on the continent that has pioneered, in my view, the most important and remarkable experiments in social organization of the past century. But we should continue to hope, and to hope that Europe remains a place that people want to come to, rather than a place people want to leave for a long time to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark, for this outstanding lecture from history to current and future challenges. We will take this with us and come back to you shortly. Professor Beatrice Raaf will now react with a speech entitled Europe's Bulwark, the Kingdom of the Netherlands and World Politics, 1815-2015, also based on her own research, and this is going to be original material, you've told us, Beatrice. Beatrice holds the chair of History of International Relations and Global Governance at Utrecht University. Her fields of interest are history of national security in the West, counter-terrorism and political violence, securitization and international relations. And as you know, among many other things, she has been chair of the recently published Dutch National Science Agenda, together with Professor Alexander Rinokan, who is also here. And in this agenda, topics such as between conflict and cooperation and resilient societies have been emphasized. Very, very important for today's subject. Beatrice de Graaf.
Thank you, André, WRR, for this invitation to be able to stand here to reflect upon Mark's very inspiring words and his marvelous works. So what I'm going to do with you today is discuss Fortress Europe from an historical and also from a Dutch background. Insecurity, anxiety, terrorism and war are all around us. They are visible, tangible on a 24/7 scale. Europe is in crisis, physically, psychologically. Ideational origins, principles are crucial to breathe new life in European institutions, Mark Mazower has rightfully claimed. My question today is, can security provide this inspirational ID, this common denominator? Mostly, principles like solidarity, freedom, tolerance, human rights, other fruits of the Enlightenment, are invoked in order to delineate our continent and its advantages vis-a-vis more threatening totalitarian or apocalyptical regimes and dystopias. However, there is another principle at work right now that might influence and shape the European community even stronger: security. It constitutes the core incentive of European integration and has done so since 1815, perhaps even before that. Security unifies, unified, and altered alike the appearance of Europe then as it does now. So it's important to stop and turn to how security affected our continent and how it affects our continent right now. Therefore, in responding to Mark's case for discerning long-run trends and a stronger focus on ideas and principles, I will ask today whether security as principle and practice binds together, recreates, and molds the continent, and to what effect. But in order to do so, we first have to address the question: threats, insecurity, terrorism, they are visible enough, but can we see, can we feel security as clearly too? Yes, we can, though we might not always be aware of the systems of protection, detection, surveillance, and defense that surround us and structure our landscapes, our physical landscapes, and our mental landscapes alike. Moreover, the extent to which security is visualized, insecurity is articulated, and the threat is projected before our eyes differs through time. Security turns its eye exclusively to the future, the British philosopher Jeremy Bentham wrote back in the 18th century. But if security is the anticipated state of being unharmed in the future, if it is the contemporary projection of impending or plausible threats that might materialize, it is also a very historical undertaking. Our imagination of the future is trapped in the past. It depends on our past experiences, on dated technological devices and dated forecasting capacities. So imagining, envisaging threats is visibly and most firmly squared in historical context. And that's important to notice. Because if we take a look back 200 years ago through Europe in 1815, it was a highly volatile situation, very chaotic. The Napoleonic era had just come to an end with the Waterloo campaigns, and Europe was back in a peaceful situation. But the country was by no means peaceful at those times, or quiet. Thousands of people, displaced persons, veterans from the Napoleonic army, were roaming through the country. Demographic numbers had plummeted in those areas, so very heavily poverty was inflicting all peoples in Europe. And the traveler on his or her way from, say, the southern parts of the Netherlands, current-day Belgium, to Paris, would see much more physical symbols and traces of security than we do nowadays. After the defeat of Napoleon and the recreation of a common European order, the Allied powers concluded treaties in June and November 1815 and pledged to forever work together in order to suppress despotic tendencies of any ruler in Europe. And this common security plan was reinforced by the presence of an Allied occupation army of 150,000 troops for the next 5 years. Moreover, a dazzling amount of money was channeled into the erection of a system of mutually assured protection by means of borders, fortresses, garrisons, fortification throughout the continent. Those years after 1815 have been largely forgotten in historical textbooks. It all ends with 1815, and then a sort of history-free period starts until 1856 with the Crimean War, and everything in between is sort of a void, a nothing. Whereas this period is highly illuminating, very interesting. not only because of all the democratic and also demographic developments that took place, but also the way security was inscribed into the continent. And the newly Kingdom of the Netherlands was one of the central linchpins in this Vienna-engineered collective security system that enveloped Europe after 1815. If we talk Fortress Europe, in 1815 the Netherlands were at the core of this system. It's very difficult perhaps to imagine for Dutch people that feel themselves a little bit at the margin of everything that goes on the continent, and we like to close ourselves behind the dikes, but back then in 1815 the Netherlands was a central focal point. So whereas today outer routes and high-speed railway lines cut through a borderless Europe, roads in 1815 were barraged by a multitude of obstacles, barriers, fortifications, and border controls overseen by the Allied powers. Those were no national fortifications. It was paid for by the Germans, the French. They were made to pay for their own defense, aggressive defense systems, the Dutch, the English, even the Russians alike. And all of these obstructions were intended to protect against the new imagined threat, which was in reality the historical threat, most notably, of course, against the French, the terrorists, white and red, and new Bonapartistic, perhaps, specters, the latest specter of terror in the European collective mind. So the whole area between Ypres, Antwerp and Waterloo was turned into one construction site. Over 17 million of guilders was spent on this system of defense. King William I, the Dutch king, and Wellington, the Duke of Wellington, the commander of the Allied armies, closely watched over the fortifications and visited those fortification bulwarks 3 weeks a year at least. So we could argue that this was the first international, supranational, created, financed, and managed mutual deterrence system Europe ever had. Not only in the presence of physical security guarantees, but also bolstered by bi-weekly Allied meetings in Paris of all the Allied powers, and also Spain and even representatives of the Ottoman Empire were there between 1815 and 1820 to oversee these security provisions. In these years, a veritable European security culture developed, binding the nations from Britain to Russia to Austria and France and Constantinople together in a unified approach to prevent chaos and to control the thousands of veterans, displaced persons and migrants roaming the country. Terrorist attacks took place back then as well. In Paris, an attack was committed at the Duke of Wellington, but he survived. However, as so many deterrent systems, in the end, the common understandings and conflation of interest did not last long. Security is a highly volatile principle. It bites its master in the heels. In 1813, after the Belgian uprising, the Kingdom of the Netherlands split in two, rendering the whole frontier, all those millions of guilders and pounds, useless. Moreover, the type of threat that was projected onto the landscape through these security measures never materialized. France ceased to be the common European enemy. The threat of large battles on relatively limited battlefields, Waterloo-like campaigns of Napoleonic conscript armies, roaming enemy lands on the rogue, became an historical specter after technological innovations in artillery and transportation changed military practice profoundly from the 1820s onwards. The early 19th century forts and fortifications became useless after 1830. Many of these circular walls and girdled forts were demolished in the half of the 19th century to make way for commercial expansion and traffic lines on behalf of the cities that they had once been intended to protect. So the projection of future threats onto the landscape by means of a barrier system turned out to be an anachronism only a decade or so later. And although Wellington had wanted King William I to turn the fields of Waterloo into a huge fortress, a fortress of Europe, the only visible reminder of the site's importance today, 200 years later, to European security and European cooperation, is the monumental lion still towering on top of a pyramid hill, not so much an invocation of future security, but rather an historical memorial to lives once lost. So security might just have been more visible and tangible back in 1815. 200 years later, security measures have become more invisible, and yet they have penetrated each aspect of our material and virtual world. Our identities, trajectories, biometric coordinates are more thoroughly mapped and charted than even the staunchest Napoleonic police officer or communist Stasi general could have ever dreamt of. Security has become almost completely obscured from sight, a omnipresent surveillance cameras reduced to centimeters, although as they have grown more diminutive and stealthy, they are becoming more penetrable each day. Markers of security have retreated behind logics of proactive, prospective risk assessment and panopticon systems that render each and every individual moving body a potential subject of risk analysis. These systems have turned a whole European environment into one unified secured space, where hardly any visible trace of security or insecurity can be recognized. Until, of course, a terrorist incident disrupts this closely monitored space and prompts new rounds of equally invisible and inadequate security. That is until recently. The return of refugees, the fear of terrorists cloaked as refugees and displaced persons, as well as fearful notions of vagabonds roaming the country, have catapulted our security concerns back into the past, back to 1945, to 1914, 18, perhaps even to 1815. Not cyber threats, not virtual security, but tragic bunches of real people defying or jamming our European standardized personal registration identification systems and stealthy villains and terrorists on their way to terrorize Europe's capital on the other, they inform our today's overarching security concerns and they trigger violent outbursts of insecurity. And at the same time, on the East European outskirts of Europe, old-fashioned conventional warfare raises its martial head over again. New defensive lines, forts and fortifications, are being erected in places like Ukraine and Hungary. So not the invisible systems of surveillance envisaged for the 21st century, but real-time 19th century security border controls are becoming common practice again. Schengen is being unraveled as we speak. Insecurity and its corresponding security and protective measures have regained historical shape. Europe's walls are going back up. It's like 1989, or I would add 1815, in reverse. Timothy Garton Ash wrote in a masterful piece in The Guardian last week. Not national fences alone, collective European walls, either with barbed wire or by means of increased control, flying border brigades are erected again. To keep Europe protected against terrorism, against refugees, to keep Europe Christian, as some Eastern European countries even have claimed. History teaches us to be cautious. The security that is created, there to be seen, border controls, passport registration, monitoring surveillance by real-life special units are extremely costly. Fortifying the Northwest European border alone costed the European countries in 1815 70 million of guilders in 1815. Today's Frontex services are estimated on €143 million annually. Moreover, such barriers impede trade, import and export, disrupt urban growth and mobility. The mind walls that are going up as well, they stoke prejudice, distract from the real threats within. Terrorists not coming from Syria, but radicalizing within the own walls or own bosom of European cities. And they cannot be stopped by walls. Collective security does serve the bolstering of common identity. It is indeed a principle that forges Europe together, even with Turkey. Like in 1815 with the Ottoman Empire, nothing unifies so strongly as a single overarching threat, be it IS or refugee crisis. This was the same principle back and then in 1815 as it is now. However, security as a unifying principle is a volatile and dangerous one. If it comes unchecked and on its own, it needs to be checked, it needs to be counterpoised with other principles and guarantees, such as solidarity, liberty, respect for human rights. At best, security binds national interests together for a short time span. At worst, it can easily backfire and turn itself into its masters. Concrete walls, borders, also serve to enhance the sentiments of insecurity. They mix up entirely legal EU citizen migrants, daily needed to keep our Western economies afloat, political refugees and terrorists. Security needs are very strong, if not the most powerful force in history. Walls, fortresses, do have effect. They kill the European dream of sanctuary. But what such walls do not is even more important. They do not prepare us against the next battle or the next coming threat. It is therefore somewhat reassuring to look back at 1815. After the huge devastation, shock and horror of the French Terror, Napoleonic Wars, Europe did find peace and solace, partly by means of creating collective bulwarks and fences. And perhaps that was felt to be necessary, inevitable at that moment in time. But soon enough, the fences and the fortresses crumbled. Not in the least because all those constructors that were paid so dearly in 1815, they were highly fraudulent and filled the insides of the fortresses with sand. So citizens of Ghent, Oudenaarde and Ypres made good use of all those fortresses. And after they earned their money through it, they dismantled the fortresses themselves. Why did they do that? Because they wanted to be able to expand, to trade, to go out, to dig canals and roads, on which new exchanges and contacts, flows of capitals, goods and people were inaugured and living standards improved, and also through which other core values and principles, such as freedom, development and welfare, would flow freely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Beatrice. That was great. Very original perspectives, originally and historically analyzed as to border security. A very topical point, of course, today. Mark, please come back to the floor and take a seat. Also, we have some time now for Q's and A's to the two speakers. If you have a question, please mention very briefly your name and affiliation and be brief in your question. Then you have the largest chance that you also get a response. First, as a warming up, Mark, a question to you as the keynote speaker. In your book, Governing the World, the History of an Idea, you say when you speak about Europe, the crisis in Europe and thereafter, you say that governing institutions today have lost sight of the principles of politics rooted in collective values of a res publica. In your speech, you made a very strong point of flexibility as a more important issue for future development. Could you reflect a bit on how to combine these two in the sense of repairing at the one hand and maybe further development at the other hand?
Sure. Well, the flexibility, I think, is just sensible, really. I mean, any organization needs rules, and anybody who works in an organization or any kind of society knows that there are rules and norms. But they also know that, on the whole, you need to be alive to the possibility that the rules served you one period may need to change for new circumstances. It's a very obvious point. The weird and interesting thing about the European Union is it doesn't find it very easy to do this. It does do it in some areas, we can think of them. But the discourse is an anxiety-ridden discourse, on the whole, in which to say that there should be some review, for instance, of the European Court of Justice, is often greeted with a response, well, but the minute you start talking about changing one thing, then everybody is going to want to change everything, and then there's going to be a Pandora's box, and the whole thing will fall apart. So that in the case of European institutions, unlike national institutions, it's as though serious debate about whether these institutions serve the common good, it's very difficult to achieve. You have to make do with whatever was agreed at the time. And I think, frankly, some of these rules and some of these institutions, it's rather debatable at this point in these economic circumstances, vastly different from the economic circumstances even of 2002 and 3, whether they really are. So, but my first point is that you should be able to do this and not in a crisis-ridden atmosphere. If David Cameron comes along and says, we need to renegotiate, then of course there will be a discussion. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about as normal part of thinking about Europe and how it serves its citizens. And I think one of the reasons why it's very difficult to think positively about Europe today is that European institutions have a very low capacity for doing this. I think the other reason is, as I say, that I'm very struck by the degree to which people engaged in political and public life in the 1940s, for a variety of reasons that may or may not have been specific to that generation, the experience of going through the Depression and the questioning of economic theory that that led to, above all the experience of fighting in the Second World War, actually on any side, meant that right across the political spectrum, from left to right, there was a much less individualism and much greater sense of politics being about one conception or another of a larger collective good than there is today. That waned for various reasons, I think, in the 1970s in particular. There was then a sort of sea change, ideological sea change, in what people thought politics was about and what politicians were capable of. And I think we suffer the consequences of that today. Now, some people will say, well, vision is an airy-fairy thing. Nobody believes in visions anymore. And they may be right about that. But I don't think having a long-term view or mapping out, in some sense, where you want to be in 5 or 10 years is a foolish thing to do. I think it's a necessary thing to do. It's extremely difficult to do it now because Europe faces these multiple crises. And as I said, these institutions are bad at crises. They're very good at something. They're not good at crises. So it's a really bad time to ask. But it strikes me that the European Union is on a kind of autopilot where the long term is concerned. And that can't be good. I mean, I have my own views of where it should go. Other people would have theirs. But the fact that there's no institutionalized mechanism for having those discussions, I think, is a bad thing.
Okay. Thank you. So could I say that the flexibility is not so much in the really important principles, but in the institutional formats?
I think it's both of these things.
Okay. Beatrice, you would like to comment on the issue of flexibility as a principle?
One sentence struck me in your answer right now. You said that people have lost their hope or expectation mm-hmm. in politicians to mm-hmm. be able to really do something. I would argue it the other way around as well, that politicians have perhaps lost the hope and the trust and their confidence in their own ability to mm-hmm. do something themselves mm-hmm. as well.
Absolutely.
And with a colleague of mine, Mathieu Segers, also from Utrecht University, we are now collecting what he calls blueprints of hope. Mm-hmm. Plans, strategies, mm-hmm. not even visions, but, mm-hmm. but real concrete strategies for European integration as they have been produced between the 1930s and the 1960s. An interesting thing is that such very pragmatic politicians like Ernst Bevin, Social Democrat, mm-hmm. he drew a plan of Europe which he called a spiritual plan of Europe. Mm-hmm. I challenge one single social democratic prime minister to draw a spiritual mm-hmm. plan of Europe. No one really would dare or try to put that on the cover. And a spiritual doesn't mean Christian. It just means that you put some core values into the strategy that you design for the near 5, 6, 7 years of future. And spiritual in the 30s and 40s, of course, had to do with capitalism. Capitalism could be spiritual in those years. And we've lost that hope, perhaps for the good. But my point is that back then, in times of similar or even worse crises, politicians mm-hmm. also supported, mm-hmm. of course, by their constituents to some part, they believed that they were able to draw such mm-hmm. designs.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. So, questions? Also, if you sit in the middle, there is some technical solutions to let you ask your question. I think you have been perfectly clear. Okay, there's no strong motivational questions. Kasper de Vries. Kasper de Vries, and second here behind. Yes, please.
Okay, So my name is Casper de Vries from the Scientific Council of the Government, I guess. My question is to Professor Matzauer. You mentioned austerity. There's, of course, a huge debate about this among economists. One reason why we are so stringent about austerity is because we distrust each other so much in Europe. Yeah. Once you give up the flexibility of exchange rate adjustments, there's only one, basically, also due to language, adjustment mechanism left over, and that is wage flexibility. Mm-hmm. And that somehow, that message never came across from the Delors report on. Mm-hmm. And basically, this has to be impounded in the mechanisms, especially in southern countries. And until that mechanism and wage flexibility is there, I don't think there's enough trust in the system to have all this investment that you are advertising.
Yes, please respond.
I mean, I think you're absolutely right that the fundamental problem actually beneath everything is the problem of trust. That's quite right. There's very little trust, and the trust has been eroded. The northern creditor nations think that the southerners are feckless, lazy gits who wanted to spend all their time in the sun and never work hard for high wages, and why should they give them their money? And the southerners think the northerners are stingy, self-serving hypocrites who in fact have helped themselves through these policies but don't want to admit it. And I don't think that's helpful. You know, stereotypes are never entirely devoid of truth. But actually, and there are real problems in labour markets in Greece. That's quite true. But there are many problems in Greece that need to be tackled. There is a serious question about what leverage European institutions have over the Greek situation and how they've used that. I think that is absolutely right. What leverage actually did the Troika have in the old days over the Greek state? I don't think they ever really understood how difficult it is to reform. So I'm absolutely with you on that point. And, you know, at that point, politically, you may be right. The North may then say, well, in that point, no kind of fiscal transfer is worth making. I think that is not right, actually, because I think there are all sorts of ways of making fiscal transfers that will, in fact, improve things in Greece. And I think the way to get things tackled in Greece is in other ways, not as a kind of, not beat them over the head. I think you need to think more creatively about its supervision within the country. That hasn't been thought through. In effect, what happened was the Troika representatives would delegate a lot of power to the Greeks. I mean, how many of them spoke Greek, for one thing, right? And then the Greek governments of the day, whether they were left or right, would just do all the easy things that didn't touch their client bases. So we need to think, and it's a very important task, maybe the most important task, how we can actually leverage credit to get the reform, because, you know, actually most young Greeks today will tell you that they absolutely want that, because they're the ones who are being shut out of the labour market. So I don't think it's a national problem. I think it's a problem of understanding the structures and the institutions and then making them work for you. And we've been slow to get to grips with that, I think. And it's starting now, perhaps.
Thank you. Yes, you had a question.
Thank you. My name is Paul Metz. I work with a Dutch volunteer think tank named the Platform for a Solidary and Sustainable Economy. And I was struck by the observation of Beatrice de Graaf, who stated that not only people have lost trust in their politicians, but politicians have lost their trust in themselves. And that's a quite serious remark. And I missed in the good, interesting perspective of Mark Mazower exactly that point, the erosion of our democracies over the past 50 or 20 or 30 years. Mm-hmm. And I refer, with our platform, we often refer to the book written in 1995 by David Corton, When Corporations Rule the World. Mm-hmm. And a few years later, Norina Hertz wrote a book, The Silent Takeover. Mm-hmm. So corporations rule the world. And last year we had here Professor Stiglitz in this same lecture of the WRR. Mm-hmm. And he stated that the TTIP is a next step in the total takeover of global governance by big corporations. I missed it. Perhaps you can add something from your perspectives to this observation. Mm-hmm. Perhaps also in correlation with Mark Mazower talked to our Prime Minister this afternoon, the lack of vision of our leading politician in the Netherlands, and perhaps those in Europe as well.
It's a question to both of you.
Yeah. No, I think I rather agree with you. I mean, and what is interesting is that I think at some point in the 1980s and the 1990s, the European and American politicians connived in a kind of limiting of their own role. I mean, they were the ones who would vote on all kinds of deregulation of capital controls, new norms that would enable, it's not only corporations, I think, but it's actually unregulated global finance as well. They permitted the deregulation of those sectors in ways that would facilitate, because the prevailing orthodoxy in the 1990s was that was the way to prosperity. And then you got the emergence simultaneously of parallel delimiting mechanisms, such as the what I think of as the German model, but it's now much broader, where because it's this curious phenomenon in which legislatures become suspicious of themselves, and so they legislate to hand over to constitutional courts, whether their own national courts or European courts, the power to police government budget policy and budget deficits in particular. So in all kinds of ways, the politicians enabled and facilitated the limiting of their own role. And why did they, and I think that was pernicious, and we're reaping the consequences. And actually we have a generation of politicians who regard that as normal. And come back to what we were talking about, you know, what strikes me so much is how important the war was. The war was very important to an earlier generation for all kinds of reasons, but I think the one was, you know, nobody thought that you fight the war without a strategy. War demonstrated the importance of strategy, and it demonstrated the importance of the state. Wars were not being fought or won by the private sector. And so people assumed the naturalness of those experiences and transferred those to the peace. And actually, as I suggested, I believe they worked extremely well for 20 or 30 years, and they were in fact the basis upon which many of the positive associations of the European idea based. So there is a kind of nostalgia in my account, but I believe it's a sort of legitimate nostalgia for a choice that politicians once made and should rethink.
Beatrice?
Yes, keyword trust. I think there are two politicians that are playing a highly fascinating and very dangerous game with trust of their society in their very endearing challenges, political challenges. First one is my favorite, Angela Merkel. I mean, if there is ever a politician who dares and who challenges, and we never expected her from her perhaps, but someone who knew her background perhaps could have suspected as much, what she does is defying all popular outcries for closing borders and for austerity measures. What she does is opening up the borders, okay, she closed them back again a little bit, but still, her core principle, she said it out loud a couple of weeks ago, is the first paragraph, the first line of the German constitution, die Würde des Menschen ist unantastbar, human dignity. And that's for her a core principle. So, and she's doing that. She's confident in her core values, and she's combining that with, of course, a very strong and a very sceptical concern for the German national interests. That's the first one. And the second one, who is also very, how would you say, he's running a roller coaster these days, is François Hollande. By calling out a war, by immediately lashing out against Syria before even knowing what was really going on in his own banlieues, he called out for war. And he thinks, and I think he rightfully thinks and claims, that the whole of the French population is behind him in yet starting another round of bombardments and campaigns. And perhaps we might just be on the brink of a new European war and crisis, which teaches us how to work again through the balance of national interests and principles. So I do think that there is too little talk about plans and strategies, perhaps even spiritual plans for Europe. On the other hand, there are politicians who on a national base stand out and are very endearing in mobilizing their target audiences through principles.
Yeah. Connecting to that, the term erosion of democracy is used. Wouldn't we also say that the very sharp debate we have publicly, politically, in the media on Europe, the institutions of Europe, the ways to go for Europe, despite all the problems we have, isn't this, from the positive side, also a very big chance to really come up with new solutions, maybe more flexible solutions than we ever had in the past? Shouldn't we use this as a chance, Mark?
I think if it's translated to the European level and thus doesn't remain a debate about how inadequate the European Union is, yes. But the difficulty is national debates remain national debates much of the time, and they only inflect European institutions so far as they're carried to Strasbourg and Brussels by politicians when they go there. There isn't a similar kind of debate encouraged by the institutions themselves.
Yeah, from an historical point of view, Europe hasn't ever been as democratic as it is today. And perhaps even, this is not what I like to be, but from a historical point of view, you could argue that it's exactly this high level, perhaps too high level of democracy, that renders the European machine so slowly. If you look across European crises throughout time, there was always a directory of one or two or three or five powers who decided over the rest of Europe. In 1815, it was the five, the Pentarchy of Vienna, including France even. And even after 1945, it was Europe, but it was predominantly, of course, United States that made the decisions. So in times of big crisis and wars, there was always a directorate of one, two, or three, or four powers, primary powers, and second range, second tier, or even third rank powers that could only watch from the margins or were only invited on an agenda base. But that really brought Europe forward. So I would like to have a discussion on not perhaps the European of the Europe of the different velocities, but the Europe of the different directorates.
Clear. Last question. Yes, please. Could you come up with the mic?
Good afternoon. This is a question from Professor Mazower. My name is Alana O'Malley. I'm a historian of the UN at Leiden University. And so I also wanted to kind of broaden the discussion a little bit. And you've talked a lot about the need for reform of the European institutions. And of course, we're also living in the context where there's a loud calls for reform of global governance overall, specifically of the UN institutions as well, of course. And so I'm wondering, what will this mean for changing forms of internationalism? Because now a lot of the politicians and representatives of these institutions are liberal internationalists who perpetuate policies based on neoliberal principles. So how will internationalisms change both within the European Union and beyond it in order to respond to this increasing growth of the feature of regionalism as part of European politics, but also as part of international politics and responses to these successive crises?
Gosh,
Mark.
not sure where to begin, really.
What do you think?
Let's just take the sort of larger bit, the UN bit, to start with. There was this really interesting guy called Robert Jackson, who had a very interesting, a remarkable war record, and then he's in the early UN team and helped set the UN up after the war. And he was absolutely superb administrator. And he accepts a position just under Trygve Lie. And they fall out, and he leaves. And about 15 years later, he's asked, maybe the early 60s, he's asked to go back and review this UN as it has emerged by the early 1960s. And he writes the first, I think, and still by far the most amusing and perspicacious review. And he basically says this is, you know, it's like trying to talk about a dinosaur with a tiny brain, or really no brain at all, because what you've ended up with is not what we intended. You've ended up with this extraordinarily complex arrangement of different international bodies that are sort of loosely grouped together in something called the UN. And some of them are more closely knit, and some of them are more semi-detached or entirely detached. There's absolutely no coordination. There's never going to be any hope now of any coordination. It's all hopeless. Doesn't mean you should do away with it, but it just means there's always going to be discussion about reform of the UN, and it's probably not going to go anywhere. That's sort of how I feel about it. Now, the reason that, I say that as somebody who's very glad the UN exists, but I think there will always be the discussion of what's the future of the UN and reform of the UN, and the landscape of international agencies. I mean, it's so striking, isn't it? If you look at the world in 1850, I don't think there's a single international agency. I can't remember when the post.
There are some.
Postal Union, two or three perhaps, tiny. So this is a late 20th century invention, and now it's so complex that it's very, very difficult to talk sensibly about this kind of thing. The EU is complicated enough, but I feel it's a lot less complicated, and actually, on the whole, for Europeans, it's a lot more consequential. And so it's really important to have the debate about the reform of the EU, because some things could change, and the rules that are drawn up really do make a difference to people's lives in very direct ways. So it's not an answer to your question. It's why I can't really answer your question, I suppose.
Final question from my part for both of you. What would you advise from your long timeline analysis and your critical view at the present and the challenges to address? What would you advise the Dutch government as, let's say, one or two important key messages to convey in relation to the presidency of the European Union? Do you have some advice there?
I think my number one piece of advice would be ban any analysis of any European problem that relies on national stereotypes. And my second would, I think, have to be you're going to have to prioritize these crises. And probably the economic crisis for me still remains the priority.
Beatrice?
To immediately translate and disseminate the national research agenda and hand it out to each representative that our governmental ministers and representatives will meet in the next months, and then take into consideration that this agenda does not only contain one, two, or three themes, cybersecurity, circular economy, whatever, but that they contain 140 themes that in its breadth and its diversity bind Europe together through science, through research, through humanities, to identity. There are also lots of questions being asked to the national research agenda about sense making. How do we make sense of our world, of our identity? How do we preserve our identity? So in order to really bring Europe forward, I would say spend money on that and not on walls and new fences.
Oh, thank you very much, Mark and Beatrice. Thank you. So the national science against agenda as an internationally binding body of knowledge. Thank you so much. So then we move on to hearing the reflection of Professor Ernst Hirsch Ballin. He is member of our council. He holds chairs at Tilburg University in Dutch and European constitution law and the University of Amsterdam in human rights. He has been, as you all know, Minister of Justice for many, many years, and he was also a member of the Parliament, both the House of Representatives and the Senate, and also a member of the Council of State, the Raad van State. Of which we have the Vice President here, Mr. Dommer. In our council, amongst other activities, he is chairing the project Public Tasks in the European Union, and we are very much eager to hear your views. Hence, please take the floor. Thank you so much.
Thank you, André, for this kind introduction. Yesterday, when we celebrated at the Asser Institute, the Institute for International and European Law, an internet university institute here in The Hague, the 50th anniversary of our institute, we also reflected on trust, the importance of trust in international relations. And we also looked back upon Tobias Asser's legacy in the first Tobias Asser lecture delivered by Professor Joseph Weiler. And I think there are a lot of connecting dots between what we discussed yesterday at the Asser Institute and the brilliant lecture and comments today we heard from Professor Mark Mazower and Professor Beatrice de Graaf, including our view that trust, part of our research program for the years to come, fits so well into the national research agenda with its avenue on conflict and coordination. Now, today, Professor Mark Mazower, followed by Professor Beatrice de Graaf's comments and debate, provide excellent starting points for us at the WRR, our new project on public tasks in the European Union. We are acutely aware of the many challenges that the government of the Netherlands will face as it begins its presidency in the first half of 2016. We have no panacea for a situation in which the seven plagues seem to have descended on EU's future. The banking crisis, the Greek near insolvency, the Ukraine crisis, the civil war in Syria, the migration crisis, the Brexit threat, and the impact of climate change. Much of this was highlighted in Mark Mazower's lecture. For numerous politicians and commentators, all this points in the same direction. The European Union should withdraw from many of its tasks, powers, and pretensions, and member states should resume their former freedom of action. That's what they say. Diminishing public support for the European Union, they argue, is writing on the wall. But are we to believe that 28 national governments acting on their own are better equipped to deal with international monetary issues, the expansion of Russian influence in its neighbor states, the civil wars in the near Middle East, migration, and carbon dioxide emissions? 28 governments acting on their own? Well, obviously, all this is not a mere question of factual knowledge. It is a question of trust and distrust in public institutions. When the European Union appears as an obese body of detached, self-serving bureaucrats and their supporters an arrogant elite, citizens will have a hard time believing that their best interests are being served. Politicians who appear to speak their language, not only in the linguistic sense, but the language of dissatisfaction and alienation, will easily win support. Is it possible to change the European Union's narrative in such a way that its policies and laws will more readily be recognized as serving the people? And will we be able to do this in a way that will not feed the sentiment that we are, in every member state and region, a collectivity that should protect itself against outsiders? Rather a fortress than a connecting open society, to use Beatrice's metaphor. After all, we are European, whether we like it or not. To be Dutch means to be European. When we assess the European project, we find that policies and laws, and not its institutional structure, are at its core. But the history of the European Union has long been burdened by the idea that a new state, a federation of states like the United States of America, is its end goal. For some, this was, and perhaps is, the political ideal. For others, it is a nightmare. In this, Europhile and Europhobe politicians and opinion leaders see eye to eye. But from the viewpoint of the common interests it must serve, policies and laws are the essence of the European Union. Policies and laws. In the groundbreaking judgments of the Court of Justice of the European Communities at that time in 1962 and 1963, the communities were seen as a new legal order in specific areas of pooled sovereignty, and to this extent an actor in international relations, but not a new sovereign state in itself. Mark Mazaur has provided us with profound insights into the history of the European Union. Surely the European communities were based on a redirection of the sources of political legitimacy. Beneath the surface of state borders in our atlases, common interests required common policies and legislation. In the early years of the communities, these interests literally lay under the surface of the states, the coal on which the mining and steel industries depended. Mark Mazaur mentioned this also in his lecture. This geological area, extending from Alsace and the Saar to the Ruhrgebiet to South Limburg and the Borinage, was the bone of contention between France and Germany in three devastating wars. But this time, instead of administration through occupation, a high authority, the predecessor of the European Commission, was created to administer this common area. It was common not because we decided to communitize it, but because the realities on the ground, or rather under the ground. Step by step, other areas of substantive common interest were included in this communitization: agriculture, nuclear energy, competition, trade, labor, services. The legitimacy of laws and policies was initially underpinned by political consensus on the principles of a regulated market economy, a fusion of the idea of the welfare state, the sociale rechtsstaat, and ordoliberalismus, tacitly accepted by Western Europe's major political streams. But this political consensus gradually unraveled in the last decade of the 20th century, when controversial areas of policy, such as fiscal policy, migration, and the labor market, were introduced, and the EU had to confront a new political climate. The Anglo-American inspired preference for a deregulated market economy, as Mark has put it, that was the prevailing orthodoxy in politics at that time, the diversification of political cultures and styles, with rapid enlargement into Central and Eastern Europe, and geopolitical instability due to power vacuums around the European Union, especially in the Caucasus region and the Mediterranean's eastern and southern shores. That created a new, different political climate for the European Union. Ladies and gentlemen, the demand of the day is to reconstruct democratic legitimacy in a way that truly meets the challenges of our times, the seven plagues with which I began. This requires focusing, in the first place, on tasks, and only secondly on institutions, insofar as they serve the common interest. This is the way in which we want to proceed with our project at the WRR on public tasks in the European Union. We will not suggest needless changes to the institutional setup, but a sober reassessment may include questions about our current dogmatic preference for uniform membership. Neither differentiation in EU tasks among member states nor EU territorial extension should be off limits to debate. The core issue is legitimacy produced by a shared understanding of the common interest. National parliaments, of course, have their roles, but yellow and red cards are no longer viable responses to serious questions. Only green cards for European or national policies, for their hybrids, or even for governance together with other actors can serve the public interest. This is, of course, a question of substance and of communicating about substance. Some Europhobes are fond of reminding us that we will never attain a truly European political legitimacy because we don't have a common European language. Poor Switzerland, with its four official languages. But this view is worse than a mistake. It is a falsification of European history, of all the interaction, trade, cultural exchange, and spreading of ideas, thanks to the ability of people in Europe to understand and translate between different languages. The preamble of the EEC Treaty, signed in 1957, expressed the desire to embark on an ever closer union of peoples. There was no official English text at the time. The word union is the later translation of Verbond, Zusammenschluss, in the Dutch and German texts, Union, with a small U in French. That was long before the European Union was created in 1992. In dem festen Willen, die Grundlagen für einen immer engeren Zusammenschluss der europäischen Völker zu schaffen, is a sentence about the relation between the peoples, not, at least not necessarily about future treaties. Verbond and Zusammenschluss der Völker, that was lost in translation. Nevertheless, many politicians, especially in Britain, but also in our country, believe that the preamble of the EU's founding treaty obliges us to create an ever more powerful institutional structure called the European Union. They take the view that this sentence should be deleted. But why, actually? Let us retranslate Verbond and enunciate that the future of the European Union is not a question of feeding and extending powers as such, but readjusting policies and laws to the needs of the peoples of Europe in our time. European law and European policies are not an instrument for the extraction of benefits for our people, the Dutch, the British, the Polish, at the expense of other peoples, but an attempt to do justice to the basic fact that we share one continent as our place to live in dignity. Mark Mazower's profound exploration of our European history reminds us of the darkness that aggressive nationalism has brought to our continent and its inhabitants. The violent reciprocity of acts of warfare must be replaced by the peaceful reciprocity of legal obligations and entitlements if we want to make Europe a better place. Thank you.
Thank you, Ernst, for presenting your broad, both knowledge and experience-based view. And we have heard that you said that we have to focus in the first place on tasks and only secondly on institutions insofar as they serve the common interest. Let me be brief now and thank you all for participating. Our special thanks to the speakers, Mark Mazor, Beatrice de Graaf, and Ernst Hirsbalin. Give them a big hand. We heard and learned a lot from you, and we'll take it with us also in our council's work to advise the government and the parliament. Presents, we'll hand it over later. The WRR invites you for drinks.